I've received a couple of comments about trying SteamOS on a Legion Go, so I upgraded the storage on my Legion Go S to 4 TB and made the switch from Windows to SteamOS. If you're thinking about trying this yourself, here's how it went for me. I started by downloading the SteamOS installation file from their support page. Rufus is a free tool you can get from the Microsoft Store, and Valve recommends using it to turn a USB drive into a SteamOS installer. This 4 TB SSD had Windows installed on it, so to avoid any issues from the old operating system, I used disk management to wipe it and set the file system to exFAT. Valve recommends disabling Secure Boot before installing SteamOS on any Windows device. I entered the BIOS by holding down the volume up and power buttons. Once in BIOS setup, I went to More Settings, Security, Secure Boot, and selected Disabled. Then I exited and saved changes. Since I was opening up the Legion Go S, I also disabled the built-in battery under Configuration and Disable Built-in Battery. This will prevent me from accidentally turning on the Legion Go S while I take it apart. There were 3 screws on the bottom that needed to be removed. Then I pried off the deco cover starting from one edge. There were 3 more screws underneath the cover that needed to be removed. I also needed to pop off the 2 top triggers, then loosen the screws underneath each of them. Again, I just loosened these. I didn't take them all the way out. Next, I used a pry tool to remove the back cover, which gave me access to the older M.2 2242 SSD. I unplugged the battery, removed the old SSD, and installed the new 4 TB 2280 SSD. After that, I just worked in reverse. Plugged the battery back in, reinstalled the back cover, put the top screws, both triggers, deco cover, and bottom screws back in. If you're thinking about trying this, I'd definitely recommend installing a different internal SSD and keeping the original as a backup. That way, if you ever want to go back to Windows, it's as easy as swapping the drive. Once everything was reassembled, I connected the USB drive using a hub and went back into the BIOS, but this time I went into the boot menu. I selected my USB, which started the process of installing SteamOS. I eventually landed on the SteamOS desktop install screen. I clicked the desktop icon labeled Wipe Device and Install SteamOS, then selected Proceed on the 2 confirmation pop-ups. All of this took a while, but if you like this video, hit the subscribe button. It helps the channel. I eventually arrived at the standard SteamOS install wizard, where I selected my language, connected to Wi-Fi, and signed into my Steam account. To get access to TDP controls, I switched back to desktop mode. I visited the Decky Loader website and clicked the download button in the top right corner. In my downloads folder, I right-clicked the Decky installer and selected execute. Since I hadn't set an admin password yet, I opened system settings, users, and created one. Then I returned to the Decky installer and selected the stable release. Next, I opened the console and entered the following command. After entering my password again, I switched back to gaming mode. Now, I can press the quick settings button, scroll down, and open Simple Decky TDP. Here I can adjust the wattage based upon what each game needs. Okay, let's talk about performance. I ran the in-game benchmarks on a few titles. I'm going to start with Marvel Rivals. For this test, I had the Legion Go S plugged in, set to 30 watts, with the resolution at 800p, AMD FSR 3 was set to performance mode, and most of the graphics settings were turned down to low. With SteamOS installed, it averaged around 69 FPS. At 1080p, the average FPS dropped to 50. Next up was Black Myth Wukong. I started at 720p, with most settings on low, FSR enabled, and frame generation turned on. That gave me an average of 77 FPS. At 1080p, I still got around 66 FPS. Next, I tested Fragpunk. I set the resolution to 900p and with shadow quality, post-processing, mesh quality, and texture quality, all on standard, my frames per second was 110, and when I went up to 1080p, it dropped to 88. Finally, I ran Cyberpunk 2077. At 800p, plugged in and set to 30 watts, the game averaged around 98 FPS, and that was with AMD FSR 3 set to performance, frame generation on, texture quality set to medium, and most other graphics options on low. At 1080p, that average dropped to around 69.5 FPS. Now, I mostly run my games in handheld mode off the battery, so I ran the same benchmarks at 15 watts, unplugged, and using lower resolutions. Marvel Rivals at 800p averaged 56 frames per second. Black Myth Wukong dropped to 67 frames per second at 900p. Fragpunk at 900p came in at 80 frames per second. and Cyberpunk 2077 running at 800p averaged 76.9 FPS. To me, all of these numbers really show just how well SteamOS is optimized for gaming on this kind of device. It's fast, efficient, and honestly, I really didn't expect it to perform this well across the board. But SteamOS isn't perfect, and for me, the biggest limitation is that some anti-cheat systems just don't support Linux, which means games like Call of Duty won't run natively. To work around that, I switched over to desktop mode and downloaded the Nvidia Geforce Now app. I selected the Steam Deck version from their website and clicked continue on the confirmation pop-up. Once the download finished, I went to my downloads folder, right-clicked the installer, and selected execute. The install was automated. Geforce Now handled everything for me. After that, I switched back to gaming mode and Geforce Now showed up under non-Steam games. I opened it, signed into my account, and it was ready to go. I'm subscribed to the performance tier, which is $9.99 a month, and for how I use it, it's been a solid value. The Windows-only games I play are all multiplayer titles, which require an internet connection, so using a cloud gaming service is practical for me. In terms of performance, it was really smooth. I haven't run into any input lag or stutter that made the games unplayable, but it's definitely going to depend on the quality of your internet connection. One thing I did notice with Call of Duty Black Ops is that I still had to wait for shaders to load. So expect a little wait the first time you launch it. As far as battery life, I started playing Doom the Dark Ages at 11:38 a.m. with the battery at 99%. Resolution was set to 720p and TDP was capped at 25 watts. By 12:38 p.m. the battery had dropped to 58%. Just 12 minutes later at 12:50 p.m. it was down to 48%, and I wrapped up my session at 12:59 p.m. with 41% remaining. That's about an hour and 35 minutes of gameplay, and still nearly half the battery left, which is pretty solid for that wattage. Okay, there was one last issue I needed to fix. The RGB lights weren't working. It's not a deal breaker for me, and honestly, I'd be fine without them, but they're nice to have. And as it turns out, it's an easy fix once you have Decky Loader installed. I switched back to desktop mode, opened up console, and entered the command to install the HueSync plugin. After entering my password, I went back to gaming mode. The HueSync plugin showed up in Decky Loader. I enabled LED control, went into LED mode, selected solid, and from there, I could change the color to whatever I wanted. Again, not a deal breaker, but nice to have. I want to take a second to mention the iFixit toolkit I used to take apart my Legion Go S. It's my go-to for handhelds like this. It came with everything I needed for the install. The tools are high quality, well organized, and they make the whole process way easier. It's hands down my favorite toolkit. I'm not sponsored by them, but I do have an affiliate link in the description if you want to check it out. I've also added links to the manuals and guides I used in case you want to try this yourself. I'll see you in the next one.